Hello everyone and welcome back to the channel for another update on Dyson Sphere program progress. So last week's stream went pretty well, I'd say. I managed to get Green Science up and running, and that was my current big push that I was aiming for in this particular one. So as you can see over here, my research is now ticking away quite nicely. It's ripping through these packs. If we look at the rate they're being produced down here, I don't think that's anything like the rate they're being got through here, but that's probably okay, because in these sort of games, research tends to be very bursty. So you'll do well you'll spend some time doing researching really, really hard and getting lots and lots of science done and getting through the packs really, really quickly, like we are at the moment. And then you'll spend a while you're busy trying to build up resources or the next science pack or something like that, at which point you'll then be leaving the system alone to an extent. So it'll give all of your science pack production a chance to catch up again. Now, we're not really in that state at the moment. As you can see, we've got very few green science packs in here. Well, as I said, we've got about 300, so that's more than it's dropping every so often. But yeah, we've got about 300 of them. So the drones are taking them away as they're required, but we seem to be basically okay with it. Now, it does look like we're a bit short on the deuterium here. This seems to be the limiting factor at the moment for the research, so maybe we'll need to have a look at that next time. But let's not worry about that for now. Looking at the facilities here, we can see we've got the matrix labs, or the matrices, massive stacks of those, and this should be, I think, if I've got the numbers right, enough to make about one per second. Although that said, they all seem to be running, sorry, one per second, one full bell, which is six per second. That said, these don't seem to be quite full, so maybe the numbers are a little bit out, or maybe it's because we're short of some inputs. I don't think it is the input problem, actually, because looking at this, both of these belts are full, and all of the machines seem to be working, so maybe I didn't quite go in at a full belt's worth. Let's do some counting. Okay, so we've got stacks of 12, so there's 48 of them in total, and these things take 24 seconds. Okay, so we're making 2 per second, not 6 per second. I think I just didn't have the input, the rate of making all of the other science packs for that. So, okay, 2 per second, that's reasonable too. I think it's not as fast as this is going down, but it's close enough that we can probably, I don't know, let's have a look. Yeah, we've got up to 400 in storage now, so it's going okay, I would say. So, how do you make green science, I hear you ask? You make it by taking one of these gravitron lenses and a blue circuit or blue processor, quantum chips. The quantum chips, we discussed this in a previous video, they're being made somewhere else on the planet. Let's have a quick look, see if we can find them. I'm only going to have a quick look because I don't want to spend ages searching for them. Here we go, yes, over here. So those are being made en masse, going into this tower here, where we have now ripped through the entire supply of them. So this system is not quick enough, but I think given that we are still churning out the science at a vaguely appropriate rate, I'm not going to worry about it too much. Oh, hang on. Sorry, this tower is the one that's acquired them all. So they've all been pulled over from that other tower into this one, and it's not quite keeping up with the rate of demand. But we have just filled an enormous buffer up, so we shall see how that goes. Yes, so we are then also, we need the processors, as I said. We also need these gravitron lenses. And those take quite a bit of making, should we say. So I was making these previously over in another area, but only sort of like one at a time. There was a very small number of them being made off the bus. So that was great as a sort of a proof of concept and giving me an idea of how the system works. But it wasn't going to be enough to actually produce a steady supply of them. So over here, once again, we can see the systems where I'm producing doing the oil processing. So crude oil is being brought in here and then processed into refined oil and hydrogen. The hydrogen is then being cooked down into deuterium by this system over here that I've touched on before. So this has been here for quite a while. Go away, I don't care about the research at the moment. The idea is that the hydrogen and the refined oil get fed into this tower here, where, as you can see, it's managing to keep it fairly full, and we're burning through the crude oil at about, in sort of the way you'd expect. So this is actually going down fairly quickly at the moment. And we're then using that. We're then using any excess hydrogen over here, potentially to turn into deuterium. And we're flowing that round here merrily, and I think we're also potentially bringing in hydrogen from off-planet. Yes, we are. And over here, what are we doing over here? And we're bringing in, in theory, deuterium over here. And this is important because we have this. The way the system works is we're producing hydrogen and deuterium all out on the gas giant. So out here, as I showed you last week, we've got some mining things on this planet out here that are that are producing the are gradually producing hydrogen and deuterium, and then that can be shipped back to the main planet. Now, because of the way this works, we've got the deuterium and we've got the hydrogen being brought in here. Excess hydrogen is then also being turned into deuterium. But we need to make sure that we can bring in, we can always bring in the deuterium, so we've also got it being brought in over here. So the basic process is, over here, we're bringing in any excess hydrogen that's being produced off on the gas giant, but we're also bringing in the deuterium to here. This means that we'll bring in any deuterium, it can be used up in the processes here down here, as you'd expect. But also, the risk is that if we produce the, if we have too much hydrogen and we turn all of that into deuterium using these fractionating columns, then this tower might fill up completely and we might not be able to bring in the deuterium from the gas giant. The gas giant might overload on deuterium, meaning that it'll then stop producing hydrogen, because I'm not sure exactly what the rules are if one of the supplies fills up. So, in order to make sure that doesn't happen, I've got this additional tower over here that's also requesting the deuterium and immediately passing it out down this belt over to here to this splitter, which is then prioritizing the stuff that's coming from the other tower before putting it into here, which is where it's actually taken from. And that means that we can always be sure that the deuterium will always have somewhere to go, because it can always go into this tower and then be passed out here and be used by priority. So we might not necessarily have this one producing all the time, but if it can produce, it will get used up by choice over the stuff that's coming from the hydrogen over here. Now that said, you don't produce deuterium particularly quickly out on the gas giant, so most of the deuterium I'm using is currently coming from the hydrogen supply, which is keeping up quite nicely over here. So I suspect we could probably put in some additional fractionating stills along here to try and produce the deuterium a bit more quickly, because at the moment it seems like there isn't really enough of it coming through. So yes, that's that step, and that's an addition to this system that was here before, and part of the reason I built it in around here was so that I could make use of this. Then, let's see, how do you make the lenses? That's the next question. Well, that requires diamonds are fairly easy. You make them just by cooking coal and then cooking the resultant carbon again. So you can see we've got the coal coming in here. It's being painted as usual. This is my standard design where you have the get a view from here, that's better. Standard design where an ingredient comes in on one side of the machines, is then fed out on the other, loops around, comes back in for the next stage of the process, and then comes out from here, loops around for the next stage of the process. And this works quite nicely because it means you can put in these paint booths along the back here to make sure everything is painted for productivity boosting on the way in. And that means we're getting 20% more carbon out for the amount of coal we're putting in. And then here we're getting 20% more diamonds for the amount of carbon we're putting in. And so on. So it makes things much, much more productive. You get more output for your inputs, which means given that we are eventually going to run out of coal, I feel like that's an incredibly important thing to be doing, because it means we can make what coal we have last for a bit longer. Then, so that's one of the ingredients. The diamonds are one of the ingredients here. You also need these strange matter capsules, and those have to be made in these particle colliders, miniature particle colliders. I want to get big particle colliders as well. But anyway, yes, they're made in these, and that requires lots of ingredients as well. We then get the endless flow of trying to get all the different things in and out. And now it's relatively easy to have four belts being dealt with by each one of these machines, because you can run these belts along here like this. I think you can even put in an additional belt like this, and then link a third inserter in like that. Yes, you can. So we could have six belts on either side of them, so six belts around this machine. And there are also another three doors on the front of it, but I'd rather not use those, because then you can't just have the belts running all the way up and down it. The problem with putting a belt this far out is the inserter then has to move over an extremely long distance, which means it takes longer to put the inputs in, to put the ingredients in, than it would if it was closer. You can see when these ones run, like that, it takes longer for this one to put the stuff in than it does for the other one. Now I think this one is also triggering twice. Perhaps the it's two for each of those. So you can see that it takes twice as long for this inserter to put the iron in as it does for this one to put the pink things in. Like that. And so if you move out even further to a third belt out, then it takes three times as long to load the stuff in. And so if there's particularly high throughput, then that can cause problems. Now in this case, it takes 8 seconds to run the build, so that's actually not too much of a problem. But you are using 10 deuteriums for this, and that's why we're getting through quite so much of it. This is a bit ridiculous, and that's why. And so I've deliberately put the deuterium on the inside belt coming along here. And the output, where we're only making one of those, is then one of the outside ones, because you only have to take one thing out to put it away. Now, the other thing you can do with these is you can stack them, and I have actually tried to do the stacking, and if we had enough deuterium coming in, we would be stacking up to 2 with this one, then up to 4 with this one. So all the deuterium coming along here would be stacked into piles of 4, and that would mean it would be much, much quicker for these machines to be able to take it in, because each time the inserter runs, it will take an entire stack of 4 instead of just a single item. Now, that doesn't seem to be a problem, because we are taking virtually all of the deuterium as it comes along. Actually, maybe we're not. When it's two quite close together, it only seems to be able to take half of it. So, yes, that basically makes my point. The inserter here is struggling to keep up, and the deuterium is... We're not short of it, it is keeping up, but we're short of it further down the line. So yes, I wanted to, because we're using so much deuterium here, I wanted to make sure this was stacked up a bit. And it also means you can fit a lot more down the single belt, so as long as we have a suitable supply of it, we can fuel a lot more of these machines. And because these things are quite slow, as I said, it takes 8 seconds to do work, to do one build. I put in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. I put 12 of the particle colliders in along here, in a sort of bit of a loop back like that, because they're huge machines. And also the iron smelters, I only needed 6 of those, because they take 1 second to run. So in order to produce a full belt of iron, only takes 6 of these machines. So yeah, that fitted in quite nicely, and it meant I didn't have to extend too far out into this lake. As you can see by the landfill along here, I have extended out a bit into the lake, but I thought it was better to loop it round rather than to have it end up all the way over here and just use up all of my soil pile. So yes, that's the deuterium talked about and the iron talked about. Then we're making the what are these things? Particle containers. So these are something to put the put the strange matter into. They're relatively straightforward to make. They're just I say it's relatively straightforward. They're electromagnetic turbines. They are copper and they are graphene, or bucky sheets, as I tend to call it. Now, copper is easy. You just have you just smelt it on site like this. And I've tended to do all of my smelting on site, which is, I think, might be an odd decision. But it does mean that rather than having a smeltery somewhere that I have to keep going out to expand every time I start using more copper, I can just ship the copper ore in, and this is guaranteed, in inverted commas, to be able to keep up. So it's probably a slightly inefficient way of doing it, but I think if I wasn't doing it like this, then some of this copper that, where we're not using these machines at the moment, some of them could be producing copper for something else. And so but this way, these machines are cheap in these sort of games. It's the resources for making the science that's expensive. So I kind of don't care. I think I'd rather put down the 6 machines here and just keep it simple, and just have the copper mine shipping out copper in large quantities and bring it out to wherever it's required. The bucky sheets you've seen before. I have a factory somewhere. Here, in fact, that's producing the bucky sheets in large quantities, because we've got carbon being carbonized, we've got sulfuric acid being made, and that's what you need to make the bucky sheets. So we're feeding those straight into a tower over here, so we've got lots of them available. And then we're also feeding them back out again and turning them into bucky tubes as well, which we don't seem to be using in quite such quantities at the moment. So at the moment we are... I feel like this is struggling to keep up, but this could be because the green science facility I was showing you has just yoinked up 10,000 of them to fill its buffers, and so we're just gradually refilling over here. It is also possible that we don't have enough bucky sheets being made, and I'm going to need to come along and boost this production at some point. We'll see how that goes. But yes, so that's bringing those in, and then the little green motor things. That's something else I did last week, so I'll touch on that in a moment. But between all of these things, we're making the copper, we're making the containing tubes, we're making the iron, and all of this goes through into making the lenses, and we're then able to feed the lenses through. Now, I've been a little bit unusual here with the way I do things. So the lenses are actually being painted on the way out rather than on the way in. And the reason I'm doing this is because the lenses aren't just used for green science. They're also used for making warp cores, I think. No, the green science... Well, yeah, at the moment... I'm using them for making the warp cores, and those are the things that allow my robot to fly really, really quickly between stars or between planets. However, in the future, I'm probably going to use this recipe, where you turn green science into warp cores, because it produces 8 times as many, and I think, if I remember correctly, yes, you get 2 green sciences out here, so it produces 16 times as many just for the cost of 1 blue processor. So that's definitely going to be a worthwhile thing to use. But that's not what I was. That's an aside from what I was talking about. The reason I'm painting these on the way out is because at some point in the future, I'm going to start putting those into my energy receiver dishes, and they're a consumable. So you'll have to keep a steady flow of them going into these dishes. But when you do, it increases the amount of power you can receive with these dishes, and so you'll be able to get a lot more power coming in onto your planet without having to expand any further. And the big advantage of and then if I paint them, then it means they'll last for 20% longer, or they'll be 20% more effective. They'll be 20% better anyway. So it'll be very worth having those in all of these dishes to make that run better. And so rather than having to take paint out to all of the places where I've got dishes, it seemed far more sensible to paint the lenses first. Then they can be brought out and just shoved straight in. So that's why, unlike everything else, the lenses are being painted on the way out over here. And then, so that means they don't need to be painted. Unlike the processors, they don't need to be painted on the way into making the science. So that made sense to me at the time, I think. At least that was the theory. And so, with green science packs, I've been able to start doing lots of sciences. You've seen them popping up as we've been talking. So I've got lots of upgrades along here being queued up. I've also been doing some extra technologies. So I've now managed to get the Dyson Sphere stress systems levels 1 and 2. And I can now start researching level 3 as well if I wanted to. And that means if I go over to my Dyson Sphere view, I'm now able to build a bit higher up. So if I select the Dyson Sphere, previously I was only able to build around the equator here. Now I can build up to the first block and the second block, because I've done Tier 1 and Tier 2. And that means I can start making these proper parts of the Dyson Sphere. Rather than just putting in struts that go around the middle, I'm now able to start filling that in with solar panels or solar sails. So the way this works is it doesn't... Oh, there we go. The solar sails fly in at the bottom here, as you can see. As you can kind of see, if I get the camera in the right place. Yes, they're flying in like this. They're being joined to the Dyson swarm, but they then almost immediately detach. I can't see any of them doing it at the moment, which is a little bit odd. I'm not sure why. Maybe it's because these are as full as they can get at the point for the amount of building we've done. Yeah, that makes a certain amount of sense, because it looks like we've filled in, for each one of these things that's complete, each Dyson Sphere frame node, we've filled in a quarter of a block next to it. So over here we've got the same sort of thing. We've got two nodes, and so we've filled in the bottom two quarters. So I think that's probably what's happening. So I can cheat this a little bit. If I put in another node here, and this is how you build up your Dyson swarm, I can then draw in like this. That's a rather funny shape, but never mind. And I can then say, make this part of the sphere. It's, as I say, a funny shape, but I don't care. And then the solar sails that are coming out to join the swarm down here. It has not done what I expected. So previously, during the stream, the solar sails that were joining the swarm were then detaching and streaming over here to be put into the into the actual Dyson Sphere itself. So I'm not sure why this section here isn't filling in, given that this one over here was capable of filling in. I'm not sure what the difference is between those two, because they've both got one node in the corner. However, I'm not going to worry about that too much, because I don't think it matters a great deal. Eventually, I'll get to the point where all of these are built up, and then we're able to. Then we've got the whole thing, all the frame built, and we can start bringing the solar sails in much more efficiently. Yes, so that we'll find out in the future. So that's to come. Now, the interesting thing is this causes a drop in the amount of power you get from your solar sails, from your Dyson swarm. So you can see across here, we've got this is the rate they were being built at before, while we had lots and lots of supply coming in. Then there's a massive dip here, because this is where the solar sails weren't becoming part of the swarm. They were being diverted and becoming part of the Dyson sphere. Oh, there we go. There's some that have been diverted. So they're arriving in the swarm, and I don't know whether that's all of the ones arriving in the swarm. I feel like that's just only some of them, which explains why there's still a bit of stuff down here. But then these will fly up here in order to go into the back of the into the node here, and then be built out into making the shell. And so that means we're now, as you can see, we are making a bit of power from the Dyson shell. It's fairly inconsequential compared to the amount of power we're getting from the swarm. It's like less than 10%, but it's sort of a progress thing. We are gradually increasing the amount of solar cells. So, but actually, if we look at that sort of gap there, compare it to 1, 2, 3, 6, 7. I reckon that's probably that gap that's producing 10% of the power that the Dyson shell is producing is probably only slightly more than 10% of the total area of Dyson swarm that we have. So I'd say this seems to be working more efficiently than I was expecting. I thought I read somewhere that the shell only produced at 50% of the efficiency or effectiveness per sail of the swarm, but you gained in that because they don't disintegrate, they don't fall out of the sky, or they don't fall apart and need replenishing. So I'm curious. I'm just going to be interested to see how this goes. But as you can see, this is now curling up here, and it'll eventually go into the back of the node and be added to the added to my Dyson sphere. And the coolest part of this is if I can spot this. Well, if I go into map view at least and look around the sun. Let's view that. You can see my Dyson swarm, my Dyson sphere starting to take shape around it, and the Dyson swarm as well is already there. We've seen that before, but you can also see that in sort of in real life view as well. So as you're flying around in space, you can see all of this stuff, and it's quite cool seeing it gradually coming together when you can manage to spot the sun just over the horizon. If I manage to spot it, I'll point it out. So yes, that's where all my power is coming from at the moment. I'm doing, well, pretty much all of my power. I do have a couple of, I still have a few wind turbines scattered here and there that were my original, this is how I'm going to produce power thing. But I've upgraded nearly everywhere to use, nearly all the power that's being used is coming from the Dyson swarm and the Dyson sphere now. So making the, as I touched on in the last video, making all of these nodes requires an enormous number of rocket launches. And at the moment, this one is, as you can see, this is only 51 out of 130 through making it. So it's taking an enormous quantity of rocket launches. I am still gradually launching them from somewhere on the end of the bus. Yes, over here. We still have gradual rocket launches happening over here, but they're very, very slow because I have one machine making rockets. So this needs to be massively expanded. And I think that's going to be my plan for next time. But for now, it's ticking away. It is building up the shell fast enough that I can be lobbing out Dyson solar sails into it and gradually producing it. But also, it seems to be slow enough that I'm also building up. I'm maintaining the swarm, and so there's still a decent number of solar sails out there producing power for that. So that's a good thing, because I don't want to start building the shell too quickly at the expense of the swarm, because then I might start to run into power problems. So if I build up a bit of base supply in the Dyson shell as it gets gradually built up, I can hopefully then gradually bring the Dyson swarm offline. But we'll see how that goes. The other big thing I did in this episode, I hinted on earlier when I was saying yes, we got an enormous flood of the small electric motors coming out here, the little green turbine things, and this has been a problem for a while, in that they're currently being produced on the bus over here somewhere. Here, we had a handful of machines producing them. I think there were six before, but I've now dropped it down to there were seven. I've dropped it down to five because I needed the space, and that wasn't keeping up with all of the things that demanded them. So what I've done is I've built them up somewhere else, and I've got them coming in by tower here. And then, as you can see down here, they're being quad stacked. So we've got two stackers to give double stacks, merging those two belts, and then stacking them again to get the quad stacks and putting them onto a yellow belt as usual there. So we've now got four times as many coming through here. These machines are all idling because they're not needed anymore, because it's all coming from here. And we're feeding an enormous number now of the quad stacked motors out to wherever they're needed. So that belt is now basically stationary, and more to the point, we're now not pulling in enormous quantities of the magnets and all the other bits and pieces that go into these things that we were struggling to make fast enough over here at the other end of the bus, where we've got where we're making the magnets and the coils over here. So this is now, it's moving things gradually off the bus to make things a little bit more efficient. I have left the belts on here in case there's anything else that uses the magnets, because I think these small motors do still use magnets, and we're still making them here, but because they're not now being turned into the green motors, they're not being used in very large quantities. So the way I've done this, and this requires me to go off to another planet, and I believe it was... Is it Silly? No, I think it was... Yes, it was Silly, because that had more iron ore. So I wanted to build up on a different planet because of the space it takes, and because I was running out, I felt like I started to run out of materials. So I decided that Silly was the better one, because that had over 5 million iron at the time, although that's now dropped a bit because I've been using it. Whereas this one actually had less iron at the time. So I've really rip through the iron on Scilly. That's quite impressive. This one has more copper, but it doesn't really need copper in quite the same quantities. Interestingly, those motors are just really, really iron hungry. Let's head off and fly off to Scilly, which is this way, and speed up. Let's see if I can hit it with boost. So going to Warpro. So this is the thing I was talking about earlier that's really expensive to make, and I'm going to try and... There we go. I actually managed to hit the planet. That's the first time I've been brave enough to actually try and do that. So somewhere on this planet, we have a... No, it's not this facility. It's somewhere else on this planet, then. Let's carry on flying until we find it. It's probably going to be on the equator, because that's the easiest place to build. Is this it? No, that's just a mine. Here we go. This is promising. Yeah. Oop. Touchdown. There we go. Right, so over here we have another one of my massive facilities, and this one will probably look fairly familiar, or the style will look quite familiar, because it's basically the same way I was building the turbines out on wherever it was I was building turbines. So over here we have, oh dear, we've run out of paint. That's unfortunate, and we've run out of copper as well. That's really unfortunate. Let's turn on remote demand here, because there's clearly not enough copper on this planet, and then suddenly we've got enormous quantities of copper being produced, provided. So it looks like we need to produce paint even faster down on Norvis. That's frustrating, because I thought I'd got to the point where we had enough of it, but oh well. Right, so I set up some copper mines on this planet, but they're clearly not capable of keeping up with the requirements, which is why all of these belts are empty. By all of these, I mean these two. But you can see here why I was saying we need so much more iron, because we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and actually 10, because this one's working double duty. We've got 10 different belts pulling out the iron, and then 2 belts pulling out copper. As always, I'm painting all of those on the way out as it comes over there, or at least I'm trying to paint them all on the way out to try and keep that going as well as possible. And then along here, we are making all the bits that are required for the motor. So first we're making the coils, which is a flood of magnets, which are made from iron, and then copper that's being smelted over here to come in. So we've got I've lined these up all reasonably nicely for the ratios that are required. So as we've touched on before, all of these take a little bit longer, don't they? Yes, this is a 1.5 second recipe, which is why there's a slightly longer line, which is why there's 9 in each of these lines rather than 6. But then over here, we're making the copper in the usual way. We've got rows of 6 furnaces there. So that means we should then, when all of these start running, we will get a full belt of copper coming out here. In fact, we could potentially, if we had the paint, we'd be getting slightly more. Well, we'd be getting a full belt out with slightly less than a belt going in. But over here, it only takes one copper to two magnets to make 2 coils. And so that because of that, I'm able to split the copper on the inputs along here. That one actually should, that splitter doesn't need to be there. That was an oversight and something I have since sorted out. So we've got, but these run, they take a second to make 2. So these are only lines of 3. But we have half a belt going into each of these with a full belt of magnets going in, and that will be a full belt of coils coming out of each one of those. Those are net. Then over here we've got iron being cooked up and then turned into cogs in basically exactly the way you'd expect. It's all 1-to-1-to-1-to-1, 1 second recipes all the way through here. So we've got belts of iron coming in, belts of cogs coming out. Simple. We combine the coils from two of these rows of coil machines over here with iron. Oh, iron and cogs. Yes. So this is all 3 of those things going in. We need the iron, the cogs, and the coils. Twice as much iron as everything else, though, which is... Have I taken that into account? Yes, I have. So over here, we've got 2 rows making the iron. It's then being stacked and merged, so we've got double high belt coming along here. So these are all the correct ratios all the way through here, making the little motors, which then come out... Those belts then go in the opposite direction, come loop round back over here, because then over here, we can turn the extra coils from the other 2 rows of coil machines and the basic machines into the electromagnetic turbines that we need, and then all of that can be fed over into this tower over here. And because that didn't seem to be enough at the time, I mean now it does seem to be, the tower is completely full, but it didn't seem to be enough at the time, so I then made a second copy of all of that. So this is actually 2 copies of everything I've just been talking about. As you can see, we've got the iron, copper, magnets, then again over here, iron, copper, magnets. And these are literally direct copies and pastes of each other. I used the copy paste function to just make a second thing of exactly the same systems, so I get twice the throughput. And that means I've now got absolutely loads of these little motors over here, and I might have overbuilt slightly, but never mind. I'd rather overbuild than underbuild, basically. There may be other places that use these things. I should probably, other than on the bus, but I can't think of anywhere where I've been making these, because these are fairly complicated. So I think I probably wouldn't have been making them on site for any of the other science packs. So yes, that's that one. We are now making these, as I say, in massive quantities, and hopefully now we've got everything we need over here, except with the possible exception. Oh, even the paint's come back in now. So now all the painting booths are filling up again. As you can see, we filled up with copper. That's coming from the other planet. That's probably coming from Titan, because I had loads of copper. And then we're feeding all that through. All these belts are now starting to gradually back up, and we're in a good position. The only sort of the most ridiculous thing in here actually is the paint belt. So as you can see, it comes out of the tower here, goes through all these paint machines all the way up here. Then it loops round, loops around here. It's getting dark, so it's hard to tell. But it loops back around here through these painters, which are the ones that are doing the intermediate products, all the way around here to get all of the things coming out of the smelteries. Then it loops back around here again to get all of the intermediate products like these motors, and over here to the cogs. Although there seems to be a bit of belt missing here, which is a little bit annoying. So let's fix that. So it feeds the paint all the way around here to get those and those. So with this belt snake, and then splits here as well to come over here to get this one and this one for the final runs into the little motors that are going into the green motors. So yes, it's a fairly ridiculously long snaking belt of paint, and it's no wonder that we keep running out of it. But it does, in theory at least, keep everything maximally productified. And yeah, all this should just work really nicely. Ah, there's the... Did I see a sunrise? Yes, I did. So now we can do what I was talking about earlier and nip over this way and have a look up at the sun. It's a little bit dazzling, but you can now see the panels coming together for my Dyson sphere, just in orbit around it. You can see the all of the sails being launched from this planet going out here into the... joining onto the Dyson swarm over there, and then that loop of them curling out from there to go into the back of the node up there, and then being built into the Dyson sphere shell itself, or the Dyson sphere in fact itself over there. So as we carry on, this will get built up more and more and more. We'll get more and more into the sails into the shell, and gradually get more and more power available. So yeah, I think this is going pretty well. Let's have another look at this. So we actually don't seem to have had too much of a drop-off with the amount of power available there. So I think there's a limit to the number. There's a limit to the rate. This is my suspicions, not something I know. But I think there's probably a limit to the rate you can put the solar sails into the back of one of these nodes. So if you only have one of them building at a time, then you only get this little bit of a drop-off in the number of solar sails that are going into the swarm. However, that massive drop-off there was because I had all four of these building at the same time, and so that was taking four times as many. So if I came over here and said I want to expand this like this, let's make a weird shape like that. Those nodes are too far apart. Okay, we'll do that then. And then I can say I want to make that into a sphere as well. So now we'll get them flowing up to this one as well, which will reduce. And if I could do the same thing over here, like this. And choose you, and now we'll see. And yes, so now we'll get the sails flying out, and they'll be going up into all of these sections that are being built at the moment, and that'll mean things will get you that will use up the solar sails a lot more quickly, and so we'll start to lose power over here, but we'll gain more power in the Dyson shell. So maybe it's worth it, maybe it's not. It's kind of hard to say. Right, so I think that's everything I have for you today. It's covered everything I've been up to recently. Where is it? So, as always, thank you for watching. Please check out the channel sponsor, that's treefoil.be. They'll give you 20% off your first month if you use the code LawrencePlays on checkout. What else is going on the channel? We've got lots of things going on the channel. So on Monday, there will be tomorrow, in fact, there will be a Factorio stream where we shall carry on building up building up vulcanite production facilities, and hopefully I'll have a chance to go off and start making production science as well. So those are my plans for tomorrow. Later on in the week, we'll have on Wednesday there'll be another Dyson Sphere program stream where I shall be going through and, well, I shall be trying to launch more rockets to build up the shell a bit more quickly. And maybe, I was going to say maybe try and launch the sales a bit faster, but actually I think we're probably okay with that. There's lots more green research to do, so I'll be looking into things to do there, and we shall see. Friday, Saturday, Sunday are the update videos, of which you're watching one of at the moment, so please come along and watch those. And we'll see if we can get some more videos coming out here and there during the rest of the week as well. And if you're a channel supporter, so that means if you've made a donation on Ko-Fi, if you're a subscriber on Twitch, or if you're a channel member on YouTube, then you'll get early access to all the videos as well. So that gives you an opportunity to see them a little bit sooner than everybody else does. So, as always, thank you very much for watching. I hope you've enjoyed the stream. I hope you've enjoyed the video. That's what I've been doing today. And we'll see you again in the next one. So, until then, thanks for watching. And actually, let's have another quick look at the Dyson Sphere. So, yes, we can now see we've got multiple different streams coming out. So, there's that one, that stream coming out here to build up this chunk of the Dyson Sphere. We've got this one coming out that will eventually meet up to there to build this one. And this stream that's going to come up here to build this one. So, yeah, that's working quite nicely. I just need to get all of these nodes built up so we can start to do things a bit more quickly and efficiently, and yes, just better. So that's going to be building up. That's going to be going out and building up these rockets, the ones that fly out and build up the nodes. And I'm going to need some more launchers as well. And I'm probably going to want to do this on a different planet. And I'm going to need to think about all of the resources that go into this, because there's a lot of stuff. Yes, a lot of stuff. So, thank you very much for watching. I hope you've enjoyed this video, and I'll see you next time for another update. Bye-bye now.